Our Bible, book of Genesis, chapter 38, verse 1 through 30. The title of today's message is The Sin of Onan and Judah. We expect from Holy Bible that there is only holy story, holy words of God in the Bible. Actually, all words of God in the Bible, holy and truth. All story in the Bible really truth. Anyway, we may think in the Bible, Holy Bible, there is only holy story. But below that verse, what we need to know is Bible, Holy Bible also, there are many, you know, not holy story, very immoral story. So today's Bible portion, you know, very immoral story. There's a story of, adultery, there's a story of prostitution, there's a story immoral sexual relationship between father-in-law, mother-in-law. Anyway, the story that we think maybe cannot be in the Holy Bible, actually there is in the this holy book. So we may be a little surprised. Why this kind of story in the Bible, Holy Bible, is a never be holy story below that verse? Because there's a very important, still very important spiritual lesson in the story. Externally, it looks a very, you know, unholy story and also immoral story. That's why not fit to, not match to our book, the Holy Bible. We think maybe this story not proper to be included in Holy Book. But externally it looks like that, you know, in the story there's a very important spiritual lesson. That's why our God included this story to our Holy Bible. Amen. Yeah. So let's see what story is here. And what very important spiritual lesson is here in this Bible portion, book of Genesis, chapter 38, 1 through 38. Okay, actually, this story is about Judah's family story. We know who Judah was. Jacob, he has 12 sons. One of them was Judah. One of them, Judah. Actually, Jacob's 12 sons finally organized 12 tribes of Israel. Finally, Jacob's sons organized people of God, nation of God, Israel. And Judah, one of Jacob's sons, and from Judah's line, from Judah's family line, finally who come? David come. And who come? Jesus Christ come. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Anyway, this story is a story of Judah's family. Yeah. So let's see. Okay, we first see what is the content in this Bible portion. Chapter 38, Genesis, chapter 38. Okay. We know the Jacob's sons, they very jealous of Joseph, because Jacob especially loved Joseph. So other sons very jealous of Judah, Joseph. Especially when Joseph said about his dream, they were angry and they more, you know, jealous of him and hated him. One day when Joseph came to the place where brothers gathered, they finally decided to kill him. They say, let's kill this dreamer. But one brother said, no, it's not good to kill him. Rather than kill him, let's sell him to Arabian caravan. So finally he was sold to Arabian caravan. Even though they did like that, the Jacob's son, they did like that, maybe after that they suffered. They must have suffered from guilt of selling his brother Joseph to Arabian caravan. Maybe Judah was the same. He suffered from the guilty. So because of the guilty, he left from the place where his brother lived. He went to the place Adullam, and there he met one Canaan woman. Our Bible don't say the name of the woman. Anyway, Judah married one Canaanite woman, and Judah began to have three sons. Yeah. First, Er, second son, Onan, third son, Shelah. Yeah. And the first son of Judah, Er, he became to marry another Canaanite woman. Her name is Tamar. Yeah. So Tamar was a wife of Er, the first son of Judah. And Bible say we don't know what Er did everything in the sight of God, but Bible say Er he did everything in the sight of God. That's why Bible say God put him to death. So Er died. Yeah, Er died. And when Er died, he was childless. Yeah, he didn't have any child. So in Israel, there is some custom, which is if one brother died without a child, another brother supposed to marry the widow, the brother's wife. Supposed to marry the widow, the dead brother's wife, and help the sister-in-law to have a son, so that dead brother's family line may not finish, but continue. And also, you know, dead brother's family can have an inheritance. Yeah. For this, there's a custom called reverted marriage. Reverted marriage. Yeah, reverted marriage. So, according to this custom, reverted marriage, you know, Onan, second son, was given to Tamar to marry her so that. You know, Tamar has a son, and the dead brother, Er's name, may not be blotted out from Judah's family, but continue. Yeah. But when Onan, he married the Tamar, Onan, he knew, even he had a son between, he had a son between Tamar and Onan, the son would not be his, the son will be the son of the dead brother, Er's. Yeah. So, and Onan, he knew that if the, you know, Tamar had a son through him, his inheritance became less. If Tamar didn't have a son, Onan, because Er died, Onan become first son. That's why Onan able to have a, you know, biggest inheritance. But if Tamar has a son, you know, the son able to have a biggest inheritance. That much Onan's inheritance became less as a second son. That's why he intentionally not try to help Tamar have a son. Whenever Onan had a sexual relationship with Tamar, what he did? He spilled his semen on the ground intentionally. Actually, Bible say it's evil in the sight of God. It's evil in the sight of God. Onan, he didn't do his responsibility of helping her sister-in-law to have a son. He didn't do his responsibility of making his brother's line to continue. That's why our God put Onan to death. So Er died and Onan died also. Yeah. Now Judah, what he should do? He should give third son as a husband of Tamar according to reverted marriage system. That's right. But when Unan died, Chela was so young, too young to marry. So what Judah said to Tamar, Tamar, Chela is still young, so I cannot give him to you as a husband. So you go to your father's household and you stay as a widow. So if Chela, third son, grow up enough to marry, I want to give him as your husband. That's why, you know, Tamar went to her father's household and waited. And some year passed. And finally, you know, Chela, third son, grew up enough to marry. So Judah should give Chela, should give third son Chela to Tamar as her husband. But Tamar, but Judah didn't give. Why? Because Judah thought, you know, first son Eru died, and second son Onan died. He thought that they died because they married Tamar. So if Chela married Tamar also, third son Tamar also, Chela also died. Likewise, Judah, he was afraid that even third son might die. That's why he didn't try to give his third son to Tamar as a husband intentionally. Now Judah, you know, her wife died. After her wife died, he finished a funeral of her wife, his wife, and he planned to go Timnah for shearing sheep. So what is a shearing sheep? It's like a harvesting of raising sheep. If you raise sheep, the hair of sheep grow, and finally, you know, cut off the hair of the sheep and sell the hair for getting money or material. So it's like a harvest for like a farmer. So to shearing his sheep, Judah, he planned to go Timnah. And now Tamar, she become to know the news that her father-in-law Judah would come to Timnah. Yeah, so when Tamar, she heard the news, she heard the news that Judah would come to Timnah, what she did, she took off widow's clothes. Instead, she wear different clothes and she covered her face with veil. At the time, you know, somebody who face her, somebody who cover her face with veil is what prostitute did. Yeah, prostitute, they cover her face and they sat on the street and waiting for men passing by to seduce them, tempt them. Anyway, like a prostitute, Tamar, she she covered her face with veil, and she go to Enayim. It's a place on the way to Timnah, halfway to Timnah. He went to entrance to Enayim, and there she sat down. When Judah passed the Enayim, she saw Tamar. He never recognized her as her daughter-in-law. He thought that she was a prostitute. So what Judah did? Judah approached Tamar, whom he thought prostitute, and he suggested, let's sleep with me. And Tamar, she asked to Judah, as a payment, what you can give to me? And Judah said, I want to give you a young goat. And Tamar said to Judah, okay, Can you give something as a pledge that you you may give or you may send me a young goat? And Judah replied, okay, what do you want as a pledge? And Tamar asked from Judah, you may give to me your seal and your seal and each code and also your staff in your hand. Three things please give me as a pledge that you may give. You may send me a young goat as a payment of my prostitution. So Judah gave three things as a pledge, code and each seal and his staff. His seal and each code and his staff. He gave three things as a pledge. And finally, Judah slept with Tamar. And after 3 months, Judah began to hear the news that her daughter-in-law Tamar, she was pregnant. So why she was pregnant? Because she did prostitution. When Judah heard the news, Judah was very curious, very angry. How? She can did like that. So Judah command immediately bring her out and have her burned to death. He was very angry and he commanded like that. And when Tamar heard this commandment from the man sent by Judah, she sent a message to Judah. Yeah. She sent a message to Judah with three things. Judah's seal and each code and his staff. And the message and Tamar's message sent to Judah was like that. I became to be pregnant by the man who owned these things. Who owned this seal and this each code, each code and each step, yeah. And his step, yeah. So finally, Judah realized what he realized. It is he who made his daughter-in-law Tamar get pregnant, yeah. So, and also Judah realized why Tamar, she did like that. Why Tamar, she disguised herself as a prostitute, waiting for Judah. And finally, when Judah come and suggest to sleep together, she accept and sleep together and got pregnant. She, Judah become to realize. The reason why Tamar did all like that, because Judah, he should have given his third son Shelah to Tamar as her husband, but he intentionally didn't give. So that Tamar's husband Eri, his family line may not continue, but become to finish. When so because of Judah did like that, Tamar whatever way to continue his husband's line, Eri's family, Eri's line. That's why she did like, even though method is bad, method is not good, but anyway, as a woman, as a widow who are very helpless, very weak, there's no way but to do like this. Yeah. So Judah realized why she did like that. And finally, she realized it's his fault. That's why he confessed, Judah confessed, she is more righteous than I. She is more righteous than I, since I wouldn't give her my son, Shelah. Yeah. And finally, Tamar was giving birth. Yeah, Tamar became to little baby. She became pregnant because of her sexual relationship with her father-in-law, Judah. And she had twin boys in her womb. And the day when she delivered come, you know, one of two boys in her womb, one boy suddenly put out his hand from the mother's womb. And the midwife, she picked up the scarlet thread and tied the thread around, tied the scarlet thread around the boy's wrist, yeah, as a mark that this boy is the first one. But the boy immediately drew back his hand. And another boy, yeah, second boy, he, you know, came out, yeah. So the boy came out as a first, become to be named Perez. Yeah, Perez. Perez means breaking out. And to say that this boy was broken out like this. Yeah. Actually, he's supposed to be second, but he come out as a first. Yeah, he broke out her womb like this as a first. So his name was recorded. His name was he was named Perez, meaning breaking out. And the second son was named Zerah. Zerah means scarlet because his hand wrist was tied with scarlet thread. You know, later Perez. If we see Matthew chapter 1 verse 3, there's a name Perez. Also there's a name of Judah. There's a name of who? Tamar. So all three people became the ancestor of Jesus Christ. You know, Judah and Tamar, they are those who commit very immoral things. They did sexual relationship even though they are father-in-law, mother-in-law. They are very immoral people. But their name in Jesus Christ's genealogy, Jesus Christ is a perfectly sinless, holy God. In his genealogy, such a immoral people, such a evil people, their name in the list. So it's a really huge grace of God. Anyway, we'll also share about that later. Anyway, this is a story of today's Bible portion. So, in this story, what is the point? Point is this. Why Onan's behavior was evil in God's sight, that he was put to death by God. Why Onan's behavior was evil in God's sight, that he was put to death by God. Second, why Judah said that Tamar was more righteous than he. That is to say, why what Judah did was evil in the sight of God, in God's sight. I think they are the most important two points in today's revelation. Based on this point, let's show words of God. Yeah. Okay, first point, why Onan? Second son, his behavior was evil in God's sight, that God, he was put to death by God. Second, you know, why what Judah did also was evil in God's sight. That's why he confessed, Tamar was more righteous than I. He said like that. Okay, first, here we need to, we already shared shortly, but we need to understand more detail, more deeply about this custom, reverend marriage system. About this system, about this law, Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 5 through 10, say about this system, reverend marriage. Here say, this was the custom, Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 5 through 10, here say, if brother dwell together, and one of them dies and has no son, the wife of the dead shall not be married outside the family to a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go in to her and take her as his wife and perform the duty of her husband's brother to her. The first son she bears shall carry on the name of the dead brother so that his name will not be blotted out from Israel. However, if a man does not want to marry his brother's wife, she shall go to the elders at the town gate and say, my husband's brother refused to carry on his brother's name in Israel. He will not fulfill the duty of a brother-in-law to me. Then the elders of his town shall go up to him in the presence of the elders, take off one of his sandals, spit in his face and say, this is what is done to the man who will not build up his brother's family line. That man's line shall be known in Israel as the family of the unsandaled. Unsandaled. Yeah. Okay, this is a description about this system, about this law. Reverie marriage. Yeah. If we say again, you know, if in the family, if there is a brothers, for example, first brother, he married, but he died without any son. First son, he died without son, what gonna happen to him? His, you know, line become to finish, because he doesn't have a sin, you know? So if in the family, if one brother die without son, so only widow remain, another brother supposed to marry the widow, the sister-in-law, and help the sister-in-law to have a son, so that dead brother's line may not finish, but continue. That's the reason for this reverie marriage system. Second, in ancient time, you know, widow without husband, very hard to survive. In ancient time, woman, hard to get the job. Even today, you know, more harder than men to get the job. Women, right? How much more ancient time? Not educated, you know, less job opportunity, and mostly labor's job, you know. That's why women, hard to survive without men, without husband. So widow, very hard to survive, husband died. That's why when in the family brother died, when woman widow won't remain, other brother married and help the widow to survive. So it's for protecting the helpless widow. That's why there is this system, reverie marriage. So, you know, the brothers of dead brother, they have a duty, they have a responsibility of marrying the widow, the wife of dead brother. If they don't do this responsibility, as described in this part portion, you know, the widow, supposed to go to elders, seniors, and refer this man. He has a duty and responsibility, marry me and help his brother's line continue. But he avoid, he not willing, then the the elders make a gathering, so call this widow and the brother and make the widow take off the brother's one sandal, and widow spit in his face and criticize him. He the man who avoid his responsibility, his duty of helping his brother's line to continue. Likewise, he criticized him publicly, renounced him, and finally, this brother who avoided his duty, his family, supposed to be called the family of unsandaled. Yeah, this family supposed to have a very, honorable name, the family of the unsandaled. Yeah. Likewise, according to this reverend Meiji, you know, if one brother die, other brother supposed to help the dead brother's family line not finished but continues to marry the widow. Yeah. Below the upper verse, especially why this reverend Meiji is a crucial. Why especially this reverend Meiji is important in you know, God's people in the line of Abraham, the family of faith, the chosen family of our God. Okay, let's see this word of God. Okay, this is God's promise to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and their descendants. Anyway, Abraham's descendant, generation to generation. This is God's promise. And this is God's willing. This is God's commandment. Let's see, what is God's promise to them? This family, Abraham's family? And what's God's will to this family? And what is God's commandment? God's promise like this. God's willing and commandment like this. Genesis 17:6. I will make you very fruitful. I will make a nation of you, and the kings will come from you. Genesis 28:3. May God Almighty bless you and make fruitful and increase your number until you become a community of peoples. And 35:11. And God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and increase in number. A nation and a community of nations will come from you, and kings will be among your descendants. Genesis 15:5. He took him, Abraham, outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars. If indeed you can count them, then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. In other words, all those words of God, what we can know? We can know God's will, God's promise, God's commandment to Abraham's family is that Abraham's family never decrease in number, never be diminished, never became, you know, smaller, but increase in number, prosperous, and multiply. It's what God believe. It's what God want. It's what God promised to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and his descent generation to generation, people of Israel. Amen. Yeah, it's God's willing. It's God's agenda. It's what God wanna do to these people of God. That's why, look at the word. That's why this reverend marriage stand very crucial. You know, now Judah's first son, Eliezer, he died, and his family line become to finish. It never be God's will. It never be God's will. God want his family never finish. Continue, generation to generation, not only continue, be fruitful, numerous, increase number, multiply, and prosperous. If you believe, let's say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our God never want his people, his chosen people, decrease in number, diminished, became small. Never, it's one, never be God's will. Opposite, our God, his chosen people being increased, numerous, prosperous, multiply. Amen?
Amen.
Now, Onan, his brother Eliezer, he died without son. No heir to carry on Eliezer's name. That family line become to finish. And definitely at that time, there is a system. Reverend Meiji. So Onan, as a second son, he has a duty, responsibility of helping Tamar to marry and have a son so that his brother line may not finish but continue, not just finish it, be increasing number, multiply, prosperous, and fruitful according to these words of God. Amen?
Amen.
But Onan, for the reason that if he help Tamar has a son, you know, he remained as a second son. Then but his, you know, the inheritance become to be less. If you know, Tamar doesn't have a son, he remained as a first son. That's why he able to get half of, you know, father's inheritance. he able to get the most father's inheritance because of that greed inheritance. That's why he intentionally avoid, you know, helping Tamar to have a son. He intentionally avoid his dead brother Er, his line to continue. It's Abel in the sight of God. That's why Arba put him to death. Amen. There are other verses. We need to interpret this spiritually. We need to interpret this one spiritually. Here are the verse. Our God never wants God's church decrease in number. Our God never wants, you know, God's people became to be diminished, became to be, you know, small, or God's church, you know, closed because of no people, no believers in the church. It never be God's will. Amen? Amen. Our God willing, His church continually fruitful, increase in number, multiply, prosperous. God's nation continually fruitful, increase in number, multiply. Our God want, you know, His the young people, children, increase in number. The young people, the children who believe in Jesus God, be increased and multiply and fruitful. And prosperous is a gospel. Amen?
Amen.
How? How? You know, church, God's church continually fruitful, multiply, increase number, and prosperous. How? How God's children who believe in Jesus continually multiply, increase in number, and fruitful, and, you know, prosperous? How? Evangelism. Evangelism. Sharing gospel. Without sharing gospel, how? Church of God be increased, fruitful, and increase number and multiply. You know, we heard the news, very sad news, you know, Europe church, you know, in the middle ages, 2000 years, very blessed, you know, very strong, sent missionary over the world. But we heard the news now, you know, many European church closed. Now the line of European church become to finish. It's never God's will. Why that thing happen? Why that thing happen? You know, European church, they have a very big building, very gorgeous building, splendid building. The building of not active, not doing evangelism. They are crazy with soccer or secular thing. They not active in work of God, not testifying, not active in sharing the gospel, not active in mission. That's why it became like this. It never be God's will. It's an evil in the sight of God. If we really say amen.
Amen.
Oh, now we should know why our God, why he did evil in the sight of God. And, you know, why our God put him to death. Because what he did is against God's agenda. It's opposite to what God wanna do. Our God won. You know, His people prosperous, fruitful, increase number, multiply. That's why definitely He should help Tamar to have a son so that Er, his family name, continue, not finish. But because, you know, he's greedy. If he help Tamar have a son, then much, you know, his inheritance became less. He lose the position of first son. Remain as a second son. That's why his inheritance became less. Because of that material greed, he intentionally spilled his semen onto the ground. He neglect, he avoid his duty and responsibility. It was evil in the sight of God. That's why God him put to death. Below that perverse, our God won, his church, you know, his people, you know, his young people, children, continually increase number, multiply, prosperous. For that, we Christians, we have a duty and responsibility of sharing the gospel actively, making this effort. But our believer, you know, never care about that. Not active with that. Only, you know, busy with, you know, earthly thing, job and money. It's just evil in the sight of God. We should know that. If we, let's say amen. If we do like that, we do like that, Una. So today was our, if we study deeply, we can know. It's very closely related with our Christian life today. You know, in Book of Revelation, you know, there are two churches that only revoked by Jesus Christ. What church? Laodicea and Sardis. Why? The Sardis church, why revoked? Jesus Christ revoked Sardis church, only revoked, no any praise. Why? You have a reputation of being alright, but actually dead. It means, look at what is the characteristic of a dead person? Doing nothing. That's the characteristic of a dead person. You know, church, if alright, should do something, work of God, pray, read the Bible, evangelism, mission. If church don't do anything, that kind of thing. It's like a Sardis church, have a reputation of alright, but actually dead. It's an evil in the sight of God. I will never please you at that kind of church. If church is a true church, should be active, alright, in doing work of God. Pray, worship, spreading gospel, mission. Amen?
Amen.
Should be very active. That's a real church. You know, church has a name, but doing anything. No mission, no evangelism, no prayer. Only believer, PGV, do you know? All silly thing, working on money, surviving. Of course, we should do that because we have a responsibility for our family, ourselves. But beloved brother, we are different from Gentile people. Book of Matthew chapter 6:33 says, huh? Seek first His kingdom and righteousness. All other things will be added unto us. We live by faith, not by sight. That's a Christian.
Amen.
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 Why Laodicea church only worked? No praise. You neither cold nor hot. Look up. Look up. No zeal and passion in work of God. That's why only worked. You know, church should be hot. Very passionate. That's a real church. So, I believe today was a very, very precious Bible portion. Actually, very related with our Christian life today. This Bible portion gives very important lesson to all Christians today. Our God won His church and His people, His group, His organization, His young people, children, His seniors, and all generation people to pray for, multiply, increase number, and prosperous. If we let's say amen. It's true. We see this word of God, right? It's a God's promise, and also God's willing, and also, you know, God's commandment. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. But Onan, what he did was opposite to God's willing, God's commandment, and God's promise. Definitely, he has a duty and responsibility of, you know, helping Tamar have a son, so that, you know, his dead brother Eliel's name not blotted out from, you know, Jacob's family. His line, Eliel's line, not finished, continued, but he avoided because of material greed. It's ever in the sight of God. Brother Abraham, we are saying today, we have a duty and responsibility as a Christian to make a prosperous, multiply, increase number our church, our Christian group, and our Christian line, and also our juniors, children, and young people, and also our family. In our family, the number of saved people, the believers, to be fruitful, increased number, it's our duty through our witnessing, evangelism, mission. If we don't do that, we neglect that, we lazy with that, we are like Una. We know able to rebut or criticize, or we know able to be seen in God's sight as a will. Second thing, Proverbs, in ancient time, you know, already say the ancient time, woman without husband, how to survive? Ancient time woman, how to survive without husband? So now Tamar, her husband died, so Onan should marry her and should be the role of husband and help Tamar to survive, and also help her to have a heir who receive inheritance, so that Tamar could be protected. But he was not willing to do that. Intentionally pour his semen on the ground. It's everywhere in the side of the ground, because he neglect the needles, desperate need of widow. Yeah. He neglect the desperate need of neighbors, very close neighbor, his sister-in-law. Yeah. So beloved, we are today saying, actually most of our people, we are very needy here in Korea. We are living as a stranger and foreigners. We are not rich. But Heavenly Father, I put our words according to words of God. If we are blessed financially, if we are needy, we are very hard to way, but if we are really blessed, we know our situation. We also duty and responsibility to share our blessing and help our needy brothers and sisters around us, in our church and around us, in God's, God's family. But Onan, he neglected Israel. That's why it was a evil in the sight of God. Beloved Proverbs, this elaborate marriage, actually everything in the Old Testament, some people say Old Testament and New Testament separate. They say Old Testament never related to the New Testament, but actually never like that. Actually Old Testament and New Testament closely related to each other. Old Testament and New Testament same. So, you know, what Old Testament say, actually what New Testament say. So, everything in the Old Testament is like a foreshadow for the thing that will fulfill in New Testament. Yeah. So, this reverent marriage also related with our Lord Jesus Christ. Actually, this system also say about our Lord Jesus Christ. This reverent marriage system is just foreshadowing our Savior Jesus Christ. The reverent marriage system was the type, symbol of something to come for Jesus Christ's redemption law for whole humanity. We whole humans were hopeless because of sin and eternal death and curses of life caused by our sin problem. We were slaves of Satan and sin and could not have God's inheritance. But Jesus Christ came to this world and sacrificed himself on the cross and opened the way of the forgiveness of our sins and the way of our eternal life. So now, any of who believe in Jesus Christ is able to be forgiven one sins and became God's children and can be given God's inheritance of eternal life and abundant life in heaven and here on earth as God's heir. We were all like the widow whose husband died without any child, so that husband's name become to be blotted out in his family life and cannot get any inheritance, and who became hard to survive without husband. But Jesus Christ became our guardian redeemer, who marries the widow of that man to produce heir, so that that man's name can be carried on in his family line and inheritance can be given. Jesus Christ has become our guardian redeemer, that when we believe in Jesus Christ, we can become children of our God, and our names can be in God's family, and we can inherit from our God eternal life and abundant life. Amen?
Amen.
So, beloved brothers, when we didn't know Jesus Christ, when we didn't believe in Jesus Christ, we are all like a Tamar, very miserable situation. Yeah? you know, we are like helpless widow, without son, without husband, without heir, so not able to inherit any inheritance. When we are sinner, people don't know Jesus Christ. We are all like a Tamar, very helpless, miserable situation. We are excluded from God's family. We are excluded from you know, the privilege of becoming God's heir to inherit you know, God's inheritance of eternal life or abundant life. We are all excluded. But Jesus Christ to save us, to become our guardian redeemer. You know, in regular marriage system, the another brother who married the widow sister, you know, and help the dead brother's line to continue. The man called kinsman redeemer or guardian redeemer. Yeah, Jesus Christ came this world as our guardian redeemer or kinsman redeemer. We are all like helpless, like a Tamar, very miserable situation. We are not able to inherit the we don't have an heir, so we cannot have any inheritance. But you know, Jesus Christ came this world as a guardian redeemer and the kinsman redeemer to save us. He came this world. He died on the cross, opened the way for the forgiveness of our sin. And he was resurrected 3 days after his death. Now, anyone who believes in Jesus Christ, sin can be forgiven. And anyone who believes in Jesus Christ, become children of God. Amen. Become heir of God, who were qualified to inherit what belongs to our God, eternal life and abundant life. Amen. Jesus Christ is our guardian redeemer. Jesus Christ is our kinsman redeemer. You know that verse? Jesus Christ to become our guardian redeemer, kinsman redeemer. He sacrificed everything of his. He opened all glory, good things in heaven, heaven privilege. He come this world, intentionally go the way of suffering, and die on the cross with great fame to make us, you know, to make us children of God, to make us inherit wonderful things of God, you know, eternal life and abundant life. If we will, let's say amen. We are so blessed because of Jesus Christ. Then we also should do like Jesus Christ. We should help others. We should also do as another guardian redeemer, kinsman leader in this world around us. You know, many people who don't know Jesus Christ, many people don't know about good news of Jesus Christ. They are all excluded from the membership of God's family. They never qualified to become Jesus Christ's you know, heir, our God's heir. They are excluded from, you know, they are not qualified, have an inheritance of our God, eternal life, abundant life. But we, who are already became heir of God, who already blessed, who already saved, we know how they came, how they become like that, became saved like us. We share good news of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, you also became like me. If you believe in Jesus Christ, you are like now widow whose husband died without any child. You are so miserable situation, happy situation. But if you believe in Jesus Christ, your sin can be forgiven. And you can become children of God. Anyone who became children of God, qualified to inherit amazing things of God's possession, eternal life and abundant life. You believe in Jesus Christ. You repent before Jesus Christ. And accept Jesus Christ as God and Savior and Lord. We can help them. We can be guardian redeemer. We can be kinsman redeemer for that. Amen? It's our duty. It's our responsibility. If we neglect that, we don't do that, we are like Onan. It's evil in the sight of God. We should know that. Amen? Philadelphia verse, today, title is The Sin of Onan and Judah. The sin of Onan and Judah. What sin? We already saying about that. Sin of Onan. And also we will say about the Judah, same sin. Brother, verse in Hebrew language, sin, hamartia. Hamartia. Okay, what is the meaning Hamartia? Hamartia means miss the target. Miss the target. Okay, I shoot the arrow to hit the target. But in this, it's not according to my purpose. That's a Hamartia. That's a sin. Our God has a purpose. Our God has a purpose to each one of us. What? We become guardian redeemer. We become kinsman redeemer. Amen. Amen. We help others that they became children of God. They became heir of God. They can inherit things of God, eternal life and abundant life. We should do that responsibility and duty. Then we become to hit the target. We become to live according to God's will, God's purpose. Then nothing. But you know, our call, all of us, as His children, for that purpose. But we don't do that. It's a hamartia. It's a sin. If you believe, let's say amen. We should realize, what is the purpose of life to us, from our God? We should realize that. And of course, we have many things in this world, but still, our main, you know, direction should be that purpose. That's a Christian. But really what we really said that, you know, today many Christians go different direction. Go different direction and never care whether they go different direction or not. If we go different direction, hamartia, miss the target, is the God's purpose of calling us to His children? Of course, once again, we have our duty and responsibility in this world. We should walk, we should have an income, support our family, ourselves. But below that, we are special people, children of God, Christian. That's not everything. Our God never called only for that. Our God never called only for our salvation. Our God called us much more higher purpose. We become channel of blessing for a nation. Through us, many people become to know Jesus Christ. Their sin can be forgiven. They have eternal life, abundant life. They, you know, live in heaven with good, great, real, and pride forever and ever. That's why we call us for that purpose. Then we should live according to that purpose. But you know, many people, they go astray, this direction, other direction, back direction, not right direction. Hamartia. Our life is very sad. Judah, today title is Sin of Onan. We haven't seen Sin of Onan until now. Now, what is Judah's sin? Same sin. As a father, he should give a third son, Shelah. Of course, first time, Shelah still young, could not give. But even though Shelah already old enough, he intentionally avoid giving. Why? He just afraid. Maybe Onan also, maybe Shelah also died. Actually, it's not Tamar's fault. Bible say, Ed died, why? What he was Abel in the sight of. We don't know exactly what Bible say. Maybe he did everything in the sight of God. That's why our God put him to death. Second, Onan, we have seen what he did. You know, intentionally spill his semen under the ground, not try to do his responsibility duty as a kinsman redeemer. That's why it was Abel in the sight of God. That's why our God put him to death. So it's all their fault. Not should be blamed Tamar. Tamar did not any wrong things. But you know, Judah is understood as if it's a fault of who? Tamar, afraid. Maybe Shelah also could be here if he give daddy, but actually not. That's why he intentioned not to give, even he's old enough to marry. And Tamar, why she was more righteous than Judah. Of course, the method she used is not, you know, perfectly right. It's a very immoral thing, right? She disguised herself like a prostitute and waiting for him. He knew his father-in-law passed that place at night. That's why intentionally she was there and sit down and waiting for her father-in-law passing. Her purpose is seduce him, tempt him, finally sleep with her, him. Yeah. So finally sleep with him. And later Judah knew Tamar pregnant, even not many, even single, as a widow, through prostitution, very furious and angry, and the command, bring her out immediately, have her born to death. But Tamar sent the message, I become to be pregnant by the man who owned these things, the seal, and its code, and this step. And all these things are the things of Judah. Judah realized why Tamar, she was able to do like that. She's a widow, very helpless, weak. So she, whatever way, she tried to continue her husband's line, not finish. It's according to God's will. Amen? Our God never want Eli's line to finish. Continue. That's why Tamar, whatever way she tried to do, according to this God's willing, God's intention, God's agenda. Yeah. Of course, the reason why she did it like that, because she's weak, not powerful. Huh? No money, no power, what should we do? Huh? That's the only way. Through that, try to make her father-in-law realize that he did wrong. He didn't do right. So, beloved brothers, the reason Judah was able to confess, Tamar was more righteous than Judah, because Judah, he didn't do according to God's agenda. God want, you know, the Eli's line to continue, not finish. But he didn't give third son Shelah to her. So if we continue like that, you know, the line finish. Yeah. It's not God's will. Amen. Our God never want this church, maybe, you know, after 1 year, this church finish. It's never be God's will. Amen. Our God, this church continue 100, 300 years. Amen.
Yeah.
How? We should continue to testify Jesus Christ. We continue to do mission, we should pray, we should do evangelism, no way. But if we don't do that, you know, maybe today, or maybe 50, maybe after 1 year, 40. If we don't share the gospel, some people go home, no newcomers, no people evangelize, and finish. Our God never wants the line of our church. Finish, never want. Continue, let the prosperous prefer, multiply and increase number. If we will, let's say amen. Then we should do our responsibility and what is the duty as a kinsman redeemer. Evangelism, sharing the gospel, mission. No way to do like this. That's why we should pray our Holy Spirit. Give us zeal and passion to do this. You know, Jeremiah, he said, even I want to stop, you know, proclaim words of God. Why? He proclaimed words of God 40 years. And, you know, almost 26 years, she continually persecuted. Because, you know, the Israel people of Judah, they are very evil. They didn't like his message. You evil, you don't defend. So you gonna be destroyed by Babylon. Don't try to resist that. God give a chance for you to repent. So definitely will be destroyed by God. Very displeasing to the ears of King of Judah, people of Judah. But anyway, that's God's message. God give that message to, that's why he no way to proclaim like that. It's not his fault of Israel people, the people of Judah. and the people slap him a stone, threw stone, and put him into cistern, persecute. That's why, because of persecution, he wanna stop. Why I suffering? It will because I proclaim words of God. I wanna stop. But if you wanna stop, he say something like a fire, something like a fire inside, compelling to proclaim words of continually. Because of that, he cannot stop. Beloved, we should pray. We also have that kind of fire in our heart, like a Jeremiah. If we don't evangelize, I cannot endure patience because of fire. We should pray. God give that fire in my heart. So if we don't share the gospel, I cannot be patient. I cannot endure because of this fire. We pray. Our God give that fire to this church. All believers. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Proverbs, this morning I heard a very impressive story from Pastor Gloria. She said there is one pastor. He go to Israel. And he tried to share the gospel to Israel people. Israel people, you know, they are very proud because they had a sense of chosen people, people of God. That's why he's a Korean American pastor. Anyway, when he tried to share gospel and he tried to invite them Bible study, Israel people they reply, "We are chosen people. How can you know?" Being taught by like a Gentile, pagan people, pagan Gentile person, even he's a Christian, but anyway, so they reject, not reply positively. So it's very hard to, you know, invite Israel people. So the pastor, instead, how to show the gospel, there's many like migrant people in Israel, from Philippines, from Sri Lanka, from other nations, yeah? And they are very positive. They reply very positively. They easily come, worship together, Bible study, yeah? Like that. So they are very good. But problem is the pastor challenge. We not only gather together worship, we should share the gospel. Let's go. And the believer say, we are illegal. So we are afraid. We go out and share the gospel. Maybe we be cracked down, arrested. What shall we do? At that time, you know, there's a believers in Saudi Arabia. Our Philippine believers in Saudi Arabia. They are working there as a nanny, something like that, Muslim family. And they are very strong Christian. So they share the gospel to Muslim people in Saudi Arabia, very strong. You know Saudi Arabia? If we share the gospel to Muslim, what will happen? Can be beheaded. But they share the gospel, so Pastor Gloria say even son of king, Saudi Arab king, became Christian and tried to be like a servant of God, like that. Now, Saudi Arabia, our migrant people, especially Philippine believers, very active. They know if they are known sharing gospel to Muslim people, it's a breaking law and they can be beheaded. But they are very brave sharing gospel. So the believers in the Saudi Arabia, they heard the news about Israel. They said, "I want to go. I want to challenge our believers in Israel." So they began to communicate, and the believers in Israel asked to believers in Saudi Arabia, "Aren't you afraid of being beheaded? Aren't you afraid of being arrested and beheaded?" And the believers in the Saudi Arabia, how reply to the believers in Israel? "Aren't you, don't you fear to God? Don't you fear to God? Whom we should more fear? Human government that beat us, or the God who, you know, sent us to heaven or hell? Whom we should fear more? Don't you fear to God?" They challenge the believers in the Israel. Saudi Arabia, hearing gospel, should risk life if you crack down, should behead it. But they share the gospel. But how about Korea? No any possibility to behead it. Very safe. If we cannot, if we don't share the gospel here in Korea, how can we share the gospel other place? I'm very touched by that story in the morning. And I believe that today, why Onan, Judah, they were evil in the sight of God. Because what they did is a hamartia, not God's purpose. Amen. Our God's purpose, our God's willing is His family, chosen family, continue, prosperous, increase number and multiply and prefer. Amen. Put that definitely Onan should do his responsibility, try to help Tamar to have a son, but he intentionally avoid for the reason that he worry he may lose his inheritance as a he could he may not have the most inheritance as remain as a second son in case the Tamar has a son. And also Judah, he was able to give his third son to Tamar and able to help her to have a son and help the first son's line to continue, but he didn't do that. That's a sin, hamartia of Onan and the Judah. So important thing is we Christian today, we should not commit same sin with Onan and Judah. Amen. We should do our responsibility as a spiritual kinsman redeemer and guardian redeemer through sharing the gospel actively to the people around us. Amen. We should try make our God's church, our Christian family, our Christian community to become numerous, multiply, prosperous, fruitful, increase in number. Amen? Amen. It's our duty and responsibility. Yeah. Okay. Let's make conclusion. Long time passed. So conclusion first. Our God wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of truth. Our God never wants His people to be decreased in number or diminished. He never wants spiritual line to finish, the line of those who have faith in Jesus Christ, but increase more and more. That's why we should devote ourselves to evangelism and disciple making to serve this God's will. If we don't do this, all will come to us, like Onan, Judah. Onan, he was put to death. Apostle Paul, he compares to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 16 to 18. For when I preach the gospel, I cannot boast, since I am compelled to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. Yeah. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. If I preach voluntarily, I have reward. If not voluntarily, I am simply discharging the trust committed to me. What then is my reward? Just this, that in preaching the gospel, I may offer it free of charge, and so not make full use of my life as a preacher of the gospel. So, once again, beloved believers, if we do our responsibility of kinsmen and individual, God will please, God bless us. If we will say amen. Real, it's true. Many people testify, I am blessed because of evangelism, sharing the gospel actively. It's true. Me also. I believe a couple of here among them also there. Eh? Evangelism blessing. Our Lord Jesus promised those who Daniel chapter 12 verse 2. Daniel chapter 2 verse 12. We know those who read many into righteousness will shine in the heaven like a star forever and ever. Amen. In kingdom heaven, like this world, not the CEO of a conglomerate, entrepreneur, or sports star like Ronaldo, they are not celebrities in heaven. In heaven, who is the celebrities? Who is the star? Those who evangelize, those who evangelize, many to face in Jesus Christ. They'll be like celebrities and star, forever, ever, shining in heaven. We should know that, survivor. But if we don't preach, oh, to us, something bad happens. Because our Lord is very disciplined. Our Lord is very disciplined. I give you time. I give you life. I give them talent. But why you have them to me? Why you don't do other things? Why you don't do what I want? Oh, to us, if we don't preach the gospel. And also, we should not neglect or avoid our duty of helping the needy people when we are able to do that. Tamar, widow. So, you know, according to Reverend Mary, Onan, Judah should help that helpless widow through, you know, giving and through bearing her and also giving also Shelah. And make her have an heir, a son. Anyway, if we are blessed financially, we should not neglect the very needy people around us. We try to do something. And also, number three, so between Judah, father-in-law, and Tamar, daughter-in-law, Perez was born, and Perez is the Jesus Christ genealogy in Matthew, chapter 1, verse 3. Perez was born through adultery, sexually immoral relationship, but he became the ancestor of Jesus Christ, which shows how much big grace God's grace is that God used such an immoral people, Judah and Tamar, who did prostitution, adultery, and very immoral thing as a channel for Jesus Christ's birth. Jesus coming this world, the Messiah of all universe, to come to this world as a savior. Such a every people were used by God as the ancestor of Jesus Christ. Amen. So if we see if we go Matthew chapter 1, there is Jesus Christ's family record, genealogy. There's a name, Judah, and the Tamar and Perez. And the Judah, Tamar, they did a very immoral thing, but still, so they are very immoral people, but their name is there. And the son, Perez, who was born between them, immoral relationship was there. And they all became ancestors of Jesus Christ. So, how can you explain? It's a it's a great grace of God that we have to explain. Who they are that Jesus Christ accept them and make them as ancestor of the holy prophet, the God and Savior of the whole universe. So that's a great grace of God. Amen? Amen. So we all also can be used by our God. Amen? Amen. Even Judah, even Tamar, they were used as a channel for Jesus Christ coming this world. We also can be used. First Timothy, Paul, he confessed people, he was the biggest enemy against God, and those who biggest persecuted against Christians, but our God, who gave him and accept him, use him as the biggest servant of God. It's an amazing grace of God. It's an amazing grace of God that we have to understand how to explain. Amen? Our God, that kind of God. The God of amazing grace. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah. So, these are the messages and the lesson giving to us through this Bible portion. Yeah. So, anyway, what we should pray? Let's pray. Holy Spirit comes on us powerfully and richly and give us zeal and passion to share the gospel to all nations people. God wakes up and we can be active in zealous in doing work of God. Especially work of saving soul, evangelism, and disciple making, and world mission, so that God's church and God's community, God's people, God's family, God's generation never finish but continue, not only continue but more and more, prefer increase number, multiply and prosperous, because that's a will of God. Amen. We pray for them. And number two, Agape Church and all those who belong to our God, to be increased in number, multiply and prosperous. Okay, now we